Hi, I'm Amy Stewart. I'm the author of Wicked Plants, The Weed That Killed Lincoln's Mother, and Other Botanical Atrocities. It's a book about the dark side of the horticultural world. I got interested in this subject after I'd written a few other books on botanical subjects, and it had kind of become my job to go around and talk to botanists about what they did for a living. And what I found out is that if you work with plants long enough, eventually you go over to the dark side. I'd be talking with somebody and they'd say, "Hey, before you leave, come look at this plant I have over in the corner of my greenhouse. Now, don't tell my boss I have one of these, but..." And it would always be some plant that was extremely deadly, dangerous, offensive, illegal, immoral. A plant that, in other words, could have some detrimental effect on humans. So I got interested in this idea that, you know, there's all these plants out there that can cause us serious harm. But I didn't want to write a poisonous plant identification guide. We already have plenty of those. What I wanted to do was tell stories. I didn't care if it could kill you. I wanted to know who it had killed. And that sent me on a journey to visit poison gardens and research facilities. For instance, in London, I visited the Chelsea Physic Garden. This place has been around since 1673, right in the middle of London. It was an apothecary's garden, which basically means it was a garden for pharmacists. You know, if you lived in London a couple hundred years ago and you had the misfortune of getting sick, this was your Walgreens. This was the only medicine we had. So pharmacists needed a place they could go that would allow them to identify medicinal plants. If you're a gardener, you probably know how hard it is to properly identify a plant, even when you have photographs. Well, imagine if all you had to rely on was drawings and woodcuts. So this place was very important. And, you know, they didn't just grow medicinal plants. They also grew poisons, because it's really important if you're a pharmacist to know the difference. I love this story from Sir Hans Sloane, a scientist and botanist. He tells about children being poisoned from eating henbane and how it made them sleep for 2 days and two nights. Now, I have to warn you, people come up to me and say, "What was the name of that plant that let you sleep for 2 days and two nights?" So do not try this at home. You might never wake up. At the Chelsea Physic Garden, they also had this great display of seeds, and this picture really raises an interesting point about poisonous plants. On the left, we have castor beans, which is a beautiful plant. I love it in gardens, but the seeds contain the deadly poison ricin, which the KGB has used to assassinate dissenters. And next to that is strychnine, which is actually a subtropical tree. The seeds have been a favorite poison in all your favorite murder mysteries, but also in real life. Dr. Thomas Neal Cream, for instance, was a real-life serial killer who murdered his patients with strychnine. And next to that is the calabar bean, a poisonous bean that grows in West Africa. And the bean was used in criminal trials to determine guilt or innocence. If you were accused of a crime, you'd be given this bean to eat. And if it killed you, that meant you were guilty. And if you lived, it meant you were innocent and you were free to go. This is called an ordeal poison, or a trial by ordeal. And maybe that's a phrase you've heard before. Now we get to the last seed in this picture, this fascinating nut, the kola nut. And this brings up such an interesting point, because the truth is, you've probably already poisoned yourself with a plant today. You've probably had coffee or tea. And those plants make a poison called caffeine. Now, we love caffeine in small doses, but there is such a thing as a lethal dose of caffeine. It's a massive amount. It'd be several dozen cups of coffee. But it is good to remember that with so many plants, it's all about the dose. So there's a lot more we could talk about between the history, chemistry, botany, and criminology involved with all of these plants. And, you know, Wicked Plants has really taken on a life of its own. A lot of botanical gardens have done exhibits based on the book. There's a national traveling exhibit right now based on Wicked Plants that goes around to science museums. It's like a haunted house where somebody's been killed by a poisonous plant, or they're plotting to murder someone with a poisonous plant, and you get to walk around and try to figure out what's going on. For a while, I even had my own poison garden where I grew a few dozen of these beautiful but deadly plants, and I marked their places not with plant markers, but with tombstones. You know those kits you can buy at the craft store to make your own stepping stones? Well, you can make gravestones with those as well. I give a lot of talks about wicked plants at museums, botanical gardens, community groups, and I do virtual events as well. So come find me online. I send out a newsletter, I'm on social media, I have a website, and I would love to hear from you.